It's interesting how many references there were about technology, right? So we know what happened when there was a big technological shift last time, right? We know the Gutenberg moment unleashed a whole thing. God, you know, has communicated through different technologies, right? Like tablets. Interesting, of course, these are the current tablets, right? And, you know, the implications of that, I think, will be significant. My head is very much in technology. I've just finished this book, just turned it into Baker a couple weeks ago. iGods, How Technology Shapes Our Spiritual and Social Lives. That's certainly where young people are. That's where the world I live in. So I think this is going to be increasingly true. I just want to have a question I want to ask us to kind of meditate upon in our tables. Has God ever spoken to you through a song, a movie, a show? Increasingly, these devices in our pockets are entertainment delivery devices, right? You're constantly getting things and hearing things. So this is a question I'd want us to maybe discuss. There's some interesting examples, right? Carrie Underwood, right? Going from, you know, American Idol to the top of the charts with Jesus Take the Wheel, or Kanye West, right? Singing Jesus Walks, or U2 singing, you know, a heavenly vision like Where the Streets Have No Name, or singing about the Holy Spirit in a song like Mysterious Ways. There's obvious examples on TV like Touched by an Angel. How many folks saw the Bible series? Did you see that? Yeah. Right? I mean, that was Roma Downey's sort of 20 years later project. West Wing fans? Any West Wing fans? Right? Remember this amazing scene where it's kind of a wrestling with God, a direct address of God, a complaint of God from the president, President Bartlett, on the West Wing. Christianity Today called Ned Flanders the highest profile evangelical on TV. I don't know if you watch Glee, but Glee had an episode that was about grilled cheeses. How Jesus showed up in a grilled cheese sandwich and kind of set a whole bunch of things in motion. So God shows up in very unlikely times and very unlikely ways, and always has. So I think in a sense, right, he said, you know, if we keep quiet, right, the stones will cry out. And so what I do in Hollywood is sort of help people understand and see what God may be communicating through pop culture. So that's a question I want to ask us about right now. Why don't you be cultural anthropologists right now and just say, has God ever spoken to you through a song, a movie, or a show? So what I'm trying to train my students to do is to tune in and to come alongside the spiritual search that's already happening. In a sense, to come alongside the chariot and sort of figure out what people are listening to, what people are reading. Where is the conversation and the spiritual search already happening? Why does this matter for me? You know, a little background. I grew up in Charlotte, North Carolina, and was, you know, into athletics and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. My early hero was Humphrey Bogart. This was the guy I wanted to be like. I liked his style. I liked his code of honor. I liked how he suffered. I liked how he drank. It's like, this is who I wanted to be. And when I heard about Jesus for the first time, I thought about him in terms of Humphrey Bogart and Casablanca, and how he had this code of ethic and this commitment to his friends, and how he outsmarted the authorities who were always trying to entrap him. The other people that really inspired me as a high school student were The Clash, because I think they had a prophetic voice about what was wrong with the culture. So I'm sort of a punk rocker in orientation, and I have the pictures to prove it. So the bigger question is, like, how does that person become this person, right? How does that person become a golfer? How does God give that person kids? You know, how would God take that kind of risk, right? For me, God reached me. I mean, you know, Randy talked about a film. For me, it was the film Raging Bull, that famous Christian tract, about a real-life boxer, Jake LaMotta, who just destroyed his opponents in the ring, and also destroyed his relationships with everybody who cared about him. Destroyed his relationship with his brother, beat up his wife, ended up at the end of his life alone, lost his belt, lost his title, lost all of his friends, washed up, overweight, in a jail cell, beating his head against the wall saying, why? And I saw that as a senior in high school, and I thought, yeah, that's the road I'm heading on. I'm that angry guy. I am that raging bull. At the end of the film fades to black, and it says, all I know is this, once I was blind, but now I can see. Whoa. I was like, well, I don't know what that means. What's that from? And so I basically saw a two-hour film about blindness, right, as a way of inspiring me towards seeing. So my theological project ever since has been sort of trying to understand how God can use, say, a profane R-rated film to lead someone on a spiritual search, right? How does God use the arts and redeem them in that way? So for me, it's about general revelation. Reform movement, Reformed Church might call it common grace. We talk about, you know, how God rains his gifts on unworthy people like Mozart instead of Salieri. Made Salieri really mad. Why is he blessing Mozart? Mozart doesn't want to praise you. For Catholics, it's Psalm 19, maybe an Aquinas thing where you're sort of looking at nature and you can see God through nature, through art. For the Orthodox, you know, it's sort of becoming partakers of the divine nature. Anyway, so after becoming a Christian, I served overseas. I went to Urbana and got a call to serve overseas. I went to Japan, and the person I worked with in Japan, who was like my first mentor, was Doug Birdsall. And so that's how I got, sort of drafted into the Lausanne thing a few years later. I've written a lot of silly movies. They always say, write what you know. So, like, I've written films about a dog who inherits his master's British title and estate and becomes part of British royalty. Little thing that happened to me. I've written films about extreme sports, even though I don't snowboard. I've done a documentary about my journey into faith, which coincided with the journey out of faith of my college roommate. So when we were Christians rooming together as sophomores, I had just become a Christian, and he was just on his way to leaving the faith. So we revisited that question. And I recently just finished a project that James Craville was involved with. We went to Lebanon and Indonesia with Dr. Roberta King, an ethnomusicologist. And we dealt with Muslims, Christians, and the potential for music to bridge the divide. Conclusion, what do I find in Acts chapter 8? I think it's amazing to me that the first non-Jewish believer in the Bible was a sexually ambiguous black man. That's striking to me, that when God chose to open his house for all peoples, right? You go to Isaiah, right? My house shall be a house of prayer for all peoples. It's interesting, just before that, it says God gave this sort of good news, it says, to the eunuch, right? Who follows my word, you shall not be cut off. A little bit of divine humor. Right? So, you know, we're having this weird moment where we're just like, got to die on the homosexual hill, right? And yet, when God chose to sort of begin his sort of broader ministry, he chose a sexually ambiguous person to build it upon. So I don't know how and what that means for us. And when I'm looking at cross-cultural ministry in the Bible, I just have to go, well, this is the way God did it. I don't know what we're going to do, but that's the way God chose.